So my special task today is to somehow to break down the big questions of the great transformation to the little transitions in the life course. And particularly, I will concentrate on the transition from school to work in Central and Eastern European countries. And in particular, I will ask the question of continuity and change in the post-socialist transition periods. And for reasons I will point out later, my special focus will be on Russia, and I will compare changes in the transition from school to work in Russia over a period from the 1960s to up to 2005. And before I will start my topic or elaborate on my topic, let me first make some remarks on the project context. So what I'm presenting today is actually a collaboration together with Christoph Bühler from the Max Planck Institute in Rostock. And the project we are doing there is situated in a broader framework of analysis of social change and especially family dynamics in Central and Eastern Europe. And in case that you should be interested in the study I present today, it's available as a working paper at the Max Planck homepage. So, my talk, I will proceed as follows. In the first part, I will present basic theoretical considerations and also some empirical trends on educational participation and the transition to work in Central and Eastern European countries, mainly based on aggregate official statistics. And then in the second part, I will draw more specifically on the Russian case on the transition school to work from the 60s to 2005. So why should we focus on the transition from school to work at all? Well, entering working life is generally considered to be a major step in the individual life course, and there's quite a large body of research available on this topic that has mainly focused on Western countries, primarily Western European countries. And these studies either focus on changes over time or difference between countries, and some of them do both. And these studies have shown some facts, and I will just give you a short overview what actually the results of these studies are. So the one finding is that actually transitions into the first job or into the labor market shape to more or less, into an extent, more or less later occupational careers. And they also affect other life domains, so like family formation, migration patterns, and so on. One consistent finding from basically all Western countries is that the transition from school to work has changed since the 1980s. So transitions have generally become less smooth. And it's also evident that the patterns of the transition from school to work are influenced both by individual characteristics and institutional factors. So individual characteristics are mostly important: education, family background, gender, ethnic background. But beyond these individual characteristics, the transition process differs significantly between societies. And this fact reflects different institutional settings. So, and with respect to these institutional settings, it's often argued that there are systematic and enduring differences in institutional arrangements, production regimes, or whatever. And we already have heard in the last presentation the typology by Hall and Soskic on varieties of capitalism, who distinguish between typically manner liberal market economies and coordinated economies. And I will not go into detail here, but just want to point out some characteristics of these production regimes on the transition from school to work and how they organize the transition from school to work. So if we talk about coordinated economies, these economies have typically a tight institutional linkage between the educational system and the employment system. Educational systems are typically highly standardized. They are stratified, so they offer different educational tracks, and they are also more or less specific on the occupational level. So Germany is, as you all know, a very clear example for this case, or it's an extreme case where occupational differentiation plays a major role in the educational system. And in this institutional frameworks, the transition from school to work has some typical features. So they are relatively smooth. So the first job is relatively stable. We find a quite high degree of coupling between educational level and the status of the first job. And we also find relatively low unemployment rates for young people. Compared to this system, in liberal economies, we find a quite different type of institution. So we find only loose institutional linkages between the educational system and the employment system. The educational system has a low degree of standardization, hardly any occupational specialization, and it's focused very much on general education. This also implies that job training is in most cases provided on the job. So job training is basically firm-specific training. And in such an institutional environment, transitions into the labor market typically last much longer, and they are riskier. So young people enter quite unstable search jobs. They often return from the labor market to education and back, and they experience high levels of mismatch between education and job. And also, unemployment rates for young people are much higher than in coordinated systems. So this is now the kind of very short summary of the typologies of capitalism and their impact for the transition from school to work. Now, if we turn to the state socialist model, so this model had a quite different kind of logic and different modes of regulation. So in the state socialist model of economic coordination, education and employment systems were coordinated by bureaucratic relationships and means of central planning. At the same time, the educational system were also highly stratified and very often also occupationally very much differentiated and specialized. And this is quite a similar pattern to the coordinated capitalistic regime type. And more directly, vocational training in these systems was often directly controlled on industry level. So that means that the supply of vocationally and also academically trained graduates was subject to a central planning process. And if we add that in socialist countries, there was a chronic shortage of labor prevalence. So there are some very clear implications for the entry into the labor market. So all together, young people had a very short and smooth transition process into the labor market. And at the same time, where graduates of different tracks were assigned to particular occupations and industries, and young people had more or less a legal right to have a status adequate employment. And of course, this system has radically changed after the fall of state socialism. So after the collapse of the state socialist societies, the mode of regulation of entry into the labor market changed completely. So now it was also market-based allocation mechanisms that came into existence. And these changes were, as you all know, accompanied by a set of changes regarding the employment system and the educational system. I will only mention shortly. So the privatization of state enterprises, establishing of new private firms, together with an economic crisis, a declining number of jobs, and a rapid tertiarization of the occupational structure. And parallel to these processes, the educational system changed quite significantly. So there was an increasing demand for general and especially tertiary educational tracks. New institutions of higher educations came into existence, and parallel to these processes, the vocational training system lost much of its former attractiveness. So against this background, we can put forward some very straightforward assumptions or expectations about changes with regard to the transition from school to the employment system. And so we can expect first a rapid expansion of general and higher education resulting in prolonged educational careers. That's quite evident. Also, we can expect that the transition from school to work became longer. So, and this was partly a result of increasing unemployment rates and problems to enter jobs for young people. And again, closely related to these features, we can expect a less strong relationship between education and job placement, and also resulting in declining chances for young people to enter qualified first job positions. So I will now give first descriptive empirical assessment of trends in educational participation for some Central and Eastern European countries. I will refer to trends in secondary and tertiary enrollment and youth unemployment rates, and I will use aggregate statistics to show you some basic patterns. So the first graph shows the proportion of students enrolled in secondary general education. It's presented as a percentage of the population aged between 15 and 18. And what you see here for five countries, on the left-hand side, it's Hungary, Poland, and Bulgaria, and on the right-hand side, Russia and Estonia. And here you can see that, in fact, in all of these countries, although on a different level and a different dynamic, that the enrollment rates for general secondary education, the enrollment rates have clearly increased. The same pattern can be found if we look at tertiary education. This is now displayed as a proportion enrolled, the proportion enrolled as students in higher education relative to the population aged 19 to 24. And here we see an even stronger increase in educational participation in all of these countries. So, and if we now have a look at the development of secondary vocational education, we see a quite different pattern. So now the straight lines are the enrollment rates for secondary vocational education, and you see that although there are differences between the five countries, the general pattern is that enrollment rates for vocational education either were declining, like in Russia, or there were some unclear patterns. So, but all in all, it's more or less a stable or declining pattern, what we can see. So we find, all in all, a major restructuring of educational participation for young adults and young people. And we can see, in fact, an evidence for rapid educational expansion in all of the Central and Eastern European countries I have displayed here. And this is very much in line what Professor Chomka was telling us today, that one of the changes was the increase in education that is a characteristic of the societies after 1990. Okay, now we have a look at youth unemployment rates. And here the pattern is quite different among the countries. There's no uniform trend. There are different levels of youth unemployment and also different trends. And if you have a look at Russia, you can see there's a characteristic increase until 1998, then decrease in youth unemployment rates. This is in line with what we know about the Russian transformation crisis and then the changing situation after 1998. Although there are no uniform trends, there's one common pattern. If we relate youth unemployment rates to the total unemployment rates, we can see that in all of the countries, youth unemployment rates were actually much higher than the average unemployment rate, which again is a kind of confirmation of the idea that young people had especially problems to enter the labor market. Okay, I will now turn to the Russian case. And so what are the expectations for the transition from school to work in the Russian case? So on the one hand, also Russia, like the other countries, experienced a process of rapid and radical market liberalization, but the Russian case has also some peculiarities. And so one of them is, or maybe the most important one, is that the state actually remained a major actor and major central actor in the employment system. So even although firms got privatized the state. The state was remaining as an owner of firms, or it was a kind of mixed private state ownership of firms. And also there was, for many firms, there was a rather weak incentives and pressures to reorganize enterprises. So the Russian market was very much a closed market in the 1990s, and there was not really much competition from the world market. So there were maybe not so many incentives to radically change organization structures and habits, how to integrate people and hire people and so on. So all in all, the expectations for the transition from school to work in Russia seem rather ambiguous, and so I will not try to pose any specific hypothesis, just compare now a transition from school to work over a long time period, from the period of state socialism to the post-socialist period. And the data I use is the Education and Employment Survey for Russia, EES, and this is a survey. It was carried out in 2005 by the Max Planck Institute in Rostock in collaboration with the Independent Institute for Social Policy in Moscow, and it's a data set on it's about life courses of people with respect to migration patterns, educational and employment careers. And it consists of 6,400 people, men and women, aged between 18 and 55. So in other words, it contains the cohorts born between 1949 and 1986. And in my analysis, there are three dependent variables. It's first the duration between leaving school or university and entering the first job, then the first activity status after leaving school or university, and then third, the first job position. And the main independent variables in my model are gender, the cohort membership, and educational degree, and there are some other control variables I will not mention here. So I will now present the basic findings. First, concerning the transition rate into the first job. So here you see transition rates derived from a piecewise constant exponential model. And what you can see here for women, these are the yellow line, and men, the blue line. You can see first for women, clearly a decreasing rates of entering the first job. And for men, we see a similar pattern. However, I want to point your attention to what has happened for the three youngest cohorts, those who entered or finished school from 1985 to the young up to 2005. And here you can see that there's basically been no change with respect to the transition rate into the first job for men. So this is quite unexpected finding. I will relate to that later. For women, it's more clear. So you see, compared to the socialist period, we have a steep decline in transition rates, which means so there's a longer duration from school to work for women. For men, the situation is not that clear. So we now have a closer look at what people actually did after leaving school. And the next graph shows you the activity status after leaving school. This is derived from logistic regression analysis and presented our odds ratios. And what you can see now for women is that there has been a steep increase in the odds to be either a homemaker or to get unemployed. So here you can see that compared to the socialist period for the two youngest cohort, we see a really strong increase of transitions from school into a position that is not a labor market position. So, and there's a very parallel development for the transition into unemployment and into the homemaker status, and also other analysis show us that actually these two statuses for women seem to be very similar statuses. So, so being a homemaker is another word for being unemployed. So, for men, there's also an increase in unemployment rates for the two youngest cohorts. Actually, this decrease for the youngest cohort is not significant, so it stays on fairly the same level. But we can also see for women, for men, a counter development. And here, you see the rates for being drafted into the army. And here, you see that in the two youngest, especially in the youngest cohort, the rates to be drafted have actually decreased, and this may explain why we have in the first graph not seen a change in transition rates from school to work, because there were two divergent mechanisms going on. So there were, on the one hand, higher unemployment rates or higher risk to get unemployed, but on the other hand, the risk to be drafted into the army after leaving school has decreased, and so on. So on these two trends, they level each other out. Okay, and final graph is on the transition, not on the transition, but it's the first job position. And you can see the odds to either enter a qualified blue collar or qualified white collar position for women and men again. And here again, if you have a look at the youngest cohort, you see for women that the odds or the chances to enter a medium level employee position or skilled worker position, both odds have decreased. So it's a clear indicator of worsening labor market chances for women. For men, the pattern is basically the same. There's a kind of freakish result for this cohort, which I cannot explain. But again, if you compare the oldest cohort to the youngest cohort, there's a clear decrease in chances to enter a good job. So these results can be further differentiated into different for different education levels. I will only report basic findings now with respect to educational level. So what we find is, first, that vocational and tertiary education reduce the waiting time for the first job also in the transition period. We also find that vocational and tertiary education reduce unemployment risks. In other words, it's the graduates with just general secondary education that have by far the biggest problems to enter the labor market. So those who have finished either vocational or university training still had significantly better employment opportunities also in the transition period. And finally, what we also find is a general pattern that the allocation to qualified jobs remains strictly dependent on educational level. In other words, the strong link between education and job position, which was guaranteed in the socialist period, is still working, although less strictly. So, to summarize my findings with respect to the trends in Russia. So first, we find a longer duration of educational participation. We also find a longer duration of transition from school to the first job. We find rising unemployment risk. And for women especially, there's a kind of a new kind of transition that has emerged, namely opting out of the labor market and gaining the role of a homemaker. We find an clear trend of occupational downgrading for younger job entry cohorts, but this does not mean that education doesn't play a role anymore. The opposite is true, so education remains actually a central factor in the allocation process, and we still have a strong educational stratification for the youngest cohorts. So, coming to my conclusions. So I think the empirical patterns we find, they do not actually support any hypothesis of a radical change of patterns in the transition to the labor market in the Russian case. So rather what we find is a kind of gradual change that has happened over the cohorts. And the empirical pattern we find, we cannot relate them to any idea of this kind of scenario of a abrupt and deep crisis in the early 1990s and then a period of recuperation. So we do not find this kind of effect of that is very common in literature, that is argued that in the 1990s there was a deep crisis with actually very much disorder in the labor market. And then after 1999, when the economy economic dates got better, that then also kind of transitions into labor markets and early careers were more normalized or whatever. So we find, if we at all find a trend, it's a consistent trend of more risks in the early career. So open questions, of course, and these are really questions I will not try to answer on the basis of my analysis. So is Russia a special case? Well, maybe yes, but of course I cannot really answer this because I only have data on the Russian case and couldn't compare them to other countries. And but what is very likely is that actually in Russia the transformation the transition from school to work in the 1990s maybe was less radical, did change less radical than in other countries. And the last point I really do not want to raise anymore after listening to your talk. So if we find any evidence for kind of hybrid form of capitalism, and I'm more unsure than ever how to answer this question. So thank you for your attention.
Jürgen Feldhoff von der University of Bielefeld. Some impressions from another field of research in St. Petersburg, Russia, a central industrialized town, of course, and not for any representative for any agrarian or the whole Russia. We found out that in first research that the system of vocational training almost crashed. The industrial production is going up, but with big demands for qualified newcomers. So where should they come from if there is no vocational training by state or by the former state-owned industries? So there are demand. The demand goes on from month to month, and the discussion is very hard. And we found out they organize it in the way that some industries who can afford make contracts with institutions, former PTUs or other institutions of vocational training, and have so some obligement for those who come to enter the enterprise as long as they were paid in their vocational training. So the vocational training is paid by the employees themselves. Another solution which we found very widespread is that no training is expected and no specific qualification is expected, and the selection process works by recruitment and by hiring and firing. Fluctuation as a principle from both sides, from the owners and managers of the new developing industrial productions, let aside the international big enterprises of car production, of the normal Russian industrial production. They work with their demand in the way of fluctuation. So they let the problem of vocational training aside and burden it on the people who are looking for work after school or university. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I'm also from Bielefeld. Must be explained. I just wonder, you nicely put it, that so many young women are taking up the choice either to be unemployed or to become a homemaker. That's a real nice term for this very old process of housewifeization. But seriously, I just, and you said there were no radical changes. I think that's a very radical change. I know you haven't studied it probably, but is there any explanation as employment was the informal or small business sector or whatever included? Or otherwise, how do these young women find nice, rich husbands to survive?
Yeah, thank you. So the first comment, I think, was kind of interesting. So it's not a contradiction to what I said. Maybe you can explain what you find better. So, okay, the question if the results for women actually is radical or not, okay, we can discuss this, yeah. But this is a pattern we find actually for I think, most of the, basically all Eastern, Central and Eastern European countries, that the role of women actually changed. Compared to the socialist area, labor market integration is decreasing. That's a clear pattern. Yeah. So you might actually say it's a radical change. Okay, no problem.
uh,
Well, it's I cannot explain it, but as I said, you might explain it by less regulated labor markets and that women are more object now to discrimination practices that were not in action in the socialist period. Yeah? You have to go deeper, of course, into the matter and also ask about values and labor market orientations. Of course, I cannot give any solid explanation of that. That may be the case. Yeah.